get credit for that.
Mazel. Let's turn up and get it poppin'.
Settle down, we still ain't got nothing.
We built this.
Tomorrow when I hit the field, I'ma keep running.
We did everything that the overseer wanted.
And if we got paid, we'd be stunned.
Sugar cane, cotton hand.
My blood is red, paid for this land. My life would have been different if I didn't have cinnamon pigment. We built this.
Every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling, 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 every day I'm hustling.
Who you suckers think you're tripping with? Yes, I'm the boss. 745, white on white, that's Rick Ross. I cut them wide, I cut them long, I cut them fat. I keep them coming back, we keep them coming back. I'm in the distribution, I'm like Atlantic. I got them pretty things flying across the Atlantic. I know Pablo Noriega, the real Noriega. He owe me 100 favors. I ain't petty player, we buy the whole thing. See, most of my homies hustle, they still do their
roof back,
roof back.
My money ride.
My money ride.
I'm on the pedal, show you what I'm running like. When they snatch black, I cry for 100 nights. He got 100 bodies, serving 100 lights.
Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day.
Never steal cars, but we deal hard. Whip it real hard. Whip it real hard. I call the charge.
Call the
I call the charge.
Yeah.
Whip it real hard. Whip it real hard. Ain't about no funny stuff. Still flipping them chickens. I'm on my money stuff. Still whipping them Benzes. Major League. Who catching? Because I'm pitching. Jose Canseco just snitching because he finished. I feed them steroids to strengthen up all my chickens. They flying over Pacifics to be specific. Triple C's, you know it's fact. We holdin' sack. So good and gon' rap.
Yeah,
run and tell them that.
Tell them that.
Mo cars.
Mo
O's.
Mo O's.
Mo clothes.
Mo clothes.
Mo blow.
Every day I'm hustling. 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 Every day I'm
It's time to spend my thrills. Custom spinning wheels. I ain't drove in a week. Them did a spinning steel. Talk about me, cause these suckers scared to talk about me. Killers talking about me. It ain't no talk about me. It ain't no walking around me. See all these killers around me. Lot of drug dealing around me. Going down in Dade County. Don't talk no
22s.
Magnum cost me
22s.
Shattered on them
22s.
Birds go for
22s.
La mama super thin, she say she
22,
she seen them
22,
we in room
222,
I touch work like I'm convertible
Burt,
I got distribution, so I'm converting the work,
in the M-I-A-O,
them switch off,
yeah,
steady slanging,
yeah,
my Chevy banging,
hey,
every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day.
Conditioning will keep it strong. Diet plan to wear it down. Do what you want and you still be melanin brown.
With a beautiful crown. Doesn't really matter how you wear your hair, little sister. Just remember to take care of it, my sister. Wear a sunbonnet and grease it at night. And don't let them pull your edges too tight.
Listen to me, honey. I know what I'm talking about.
That's right.
Fabulous.
Gorgeous. Go ahead, girl.
Fresh.
Sexy.
Fine. Regal.
Regal.
Bad to the bone.
Hair or not, if it's kinky, curly, or cropped. Fox braid, Senegalese twist, straight weaves down to my wrist. Doesn't matter if your hair is short or long. Deep conditioning will keep it strong.
That's right, girl.
Dye it, not a braid it down. Do what you want and still be melanin brown.
Melanin brown.
Melanin brown.
Melanin
brown. With the beautiful crown.
My leg.
You know, we really should be doing.
Thank you. Juneteenth, it was the 20th, but the 19th's when it was told to us.
It's time to vote for me to take part in this democracy.
Tell them freedom papers up, please, cause we don't need to show ID.
It's June 19th, we celebrate.
Grab a blonde and miscegenate.
Welcome. My name is Adele Hickson Day, and I'm the new Chief Advancement Officer here at the museum, and I'm here to welcome you guys. Kevin Young has served as the Andrew W. Mellon Director of the Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture since January 2021. An award-winning poet and author, Director Young is a self-described leader who imbues his vision for the museum with a deep commitment to living history, connecting the past to the present with collections and stories that help us better understand our current moment as well as we build into the future. Director Young's remarkable career has spanned more than two decades across educational and cultural institutions. Prior to joining the museum, he was the director of the New York Public Library's Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture. He earlier served as a curator at Emory University. Since joining the National Museum of African American History and Culture, Director Young has managed the launch of the museum's fifth anniversary, the award-winning searchable museum platform, two critically acclaimed exhibitions, and the museum's Living History campaign, which is building its endowment and supporting ongoing programming and digital initiatives. Director Young serves as a poetry editor for The New Yorker, where he hosts the magazine's poetry podcast. In addition, he is the author of 14 books of poetry and prose, and the editor of 9 volumes, as well as the author of nonfiction work. His first children's book, A Meal in the Field, was released in March. Director Young's talent, vision, and leadership have been recognized with numerous honors, including the Guggenheim Foundation Fellowship, the Stegner Fellowship in Poetry at Stanford University, a McDowell Colony Fellowship. He is a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the American Academy of Arts and Letters, the Society of American Historians, and was named a Chancellor of the American Academy of Poets in 2020. As noted by a panel of judges for the Penn Open Book Award, Young goes far beyond just being a documentarian of American Black identity. He shows us how Black identity is indispensable to American culture. Please join me in welcoming the Andrew W. Mellon, Director of the National Museum of African American History and Culture, Kevin Young.
Thanks, Adele. Thanks so much, Adele. How are you, everyone? Okay. Let's try that again. How is everyone? All right, welcome. I'm Kevin Young, the Mellon Director of the National Museum of African American History and Culture, or as my mom says, the person who can finally get her tickets to the museum. So I'm really honored tonight to welcome you all and to celebrate the legacy of Jackie Robinson, a day 75 years in the making. I'm especially grateful to the Sports Leadership Council who helped make tonight possible, including the Brooklyn Nets and the New York Liberty Foundation, Robert K. Kraft Family and the New York Patriots Charitable Foundation, Spurs Sports and Entertainment, and the Washington Commanders. Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you. As you know, 75 years ago today, on April 15th, 1947, Robinson changed the world in Major League Baseball when he stepped onto the field and started at first base for the Brooklyn Dodgers. And now his legacy extends for 75 years. I hope that many of you were able to see the jersey displayed in our sports gallery upstairs this evening. We're really honored to be able to share his story and impact as we have since the opening of the museum. Now, I played a little Little League myself on an all-black team, no less, and came to love the game, but even as I swung the bat, or stole a base, or won a game as a pitcher, which happened once, I knew I was part of a long tradition of Black players who recognized sports as a game changer and transformed America's pastime into a level playing field. Players like Robinson, or Roberto Clemente, or Hank Aaron, and other pioneers inspired me as a kid, and later, as a poet, when I wrote of them and sang their praises. You weren't always safe, Jackie Robinson taught us. But in baseball, as in life, you could find yourself home, even if you had to steal it. Okay, right, right. Many players like Robinson extended their influence from the field to civil rights struggles across the country, advocating not just for their own inclusion, but for greater opportunities and access for the broader African-American community. The story of Black achievement in sports is never just about the game. And that is why we celebrate Jackie Robinson today. Not just for his unparalleled contributions to baseball, but also for becoming the first Black television analyst for MLB, and an instrumental leader in establishing the Freedom National Bank. For almost two decades now, MLB has celebrated Jackie Robinson Day, and although his iconic number, the 42, was retired across all major league teams, every player on every team wears the number 42 on April 15th today. All right, let's give that a round of applause. So 75 years later, that is a fitting tribute to a man whose impact extends across baseball and indeed across generations of Americans. His legacy continues on and off the field, and we are honored and excited to celebrate him tonight. Thank you all for coming out, and talk to you soon.
Thank you, Director Young. Now let's introduce our panelists for this evening. Please welcome culture, sports writer, and senior writer at Andscape, Justin Tinsley. Associate Professor of Afro-American Studies at Howard University, Dr. Greg Carr. American professional softball player, media personality, and model, Ayana A.J. Andrews. Vice President and Club Counsel for the Boston Red Sox, Elaine Weddington Steward. Author, speaker, and curator of sports for the Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture, Dr. Damion Thomas.
All right, my mic is on, so I guess that's my cue to go. Again, my name is Justin Tinsley, and to say being on this panel with these men and women is a privilege would be a vast understatement. To be on this stage talking about this topic on this day, it's something I've been thinking about for weeks now. And even before we get into this Q&A, and I'll shut up soon, I promise you that. And I want to say this date, April 15th, 1947. It's the reason that we're all here. And it's the that date changed all of our lives, whether we know it or not. And I would venture to say that most people in here, and probably watching online, I won't say all, but most people weren't even born by then. So our lives changed even before we had a life. So when you think of April 15th, 1947, let me try to put the world in context of what it looked like then. The NBA was 5 months old. The NBA was 5 months old. The first Freedom Ride took place in April 1947 in the South. But here's this. Emmett Till was 5 years old. Richard Pryor was 6. Malcolm X wasn't even Malcolm X then. He was still sitting in prison. But if you read his autobiography, and despite the tense nature that they had in the 60s with one another, he said one of the most important, one of the most impactful days, and one of the happiest days he ever had incarcerated was April 15th, 1947. Martin Luther King was 18. Coretta Scott King was 19. My grandmother, she was 15. She turns 91 next month. So basically, the point is like, all right, Justin, what do you mean by all this? The point is, history isn't always ancient. History is very much alive. And that's why this museum is here. That's why this discussion matters. That's why everybody on this stage is important, because they're gonna offer a different perspective and a different insight into Jackie Robinson and him breaking the color barrier. So that's probably the closest thing I'm gonna ever get to a Grammy speech, so we can start now. So we're gonna start. Thank you for that. Damion, I wanna start with you. Like, anybody with the remote idea of what this museum is has to have an understanding that at some point Jackie Robinson's name is going to come up. And if for anybody who's happened to walk the third floor, you saw the jersey here. I know the significance of the jersey. It's Jackie Robinson's jersey, but what was the backstory and how that jersey actually got here to the museum?
We actually have two Jackie Robinsons, probably only five known surviving Jackie Robinson jerseys. So to have two of them is really special and important. If you think about the jersey that's at the front of the gallery, that is owned by an anonymous lender who lived in one of the towns where one of the Dodgers farm teams played. And so there was a gentleman who owned a sports goods store who would go down to spring training and gather scraps and sell them in a sporting goods store. And so this guy grabbed some of the old jerseys and would sell them. So this guy, he was a baseball player, and he bought this jersey for $2 to wear to practice. And so he wore Jackie Robinson's jersey to his high school baseball practice. This is when that time that people were really collecting sports memorabilia and certainly weren't placing a priority on African-American athletes' sports memorabilia. And so he went away to college. His mother decided to move to Florida 50 years later. So then he's going through all of his high school belongings and uncovers this jersey. So it's an amazing moment. At that point, it was probably worth $1 million. And in a private sale, the Jackie Robinson jersey recently sold north of $4 million. But also want to mention the other jersey as well, because that jersey comes from the Jock Smith collection, and Jock Smith was one of the four founding attorneys for the Johnny Cochran firm. And Jock Smith was a civil rights attorney who won legendary cases across the country, hundreds of millions. I believe over $1 billion worth of settlements fighting for justice for African Americans. And he became the preeminent collector of African American sports memorabilia. And so his daughter, Janae, allowed us to borrow a lot of the items, including the Jackie Robinson, and donated a tremendous amount of objects to this museum. And so we really started with the items that she donated to the museum, was the foundation of our collection. And so based upon the willingness of countless people, we've really been able to build a world-class collection that allows us to share African-American history through the lens of sports.
I mean, that's such a beautiful story, and like the backstory of how that came to be is so important, because if you talk about Jackie Robinson's story, his story is not just about him. It's about the countless black men, black women, boys and girls that he wanted to inspire and make life a little less chaotic than it was for him. And you know, we're celebrating the 75th anniversary of Jackie breaking the color barrier, but we're also coming up on another big anniversary next month. It's 50 years since Title IX. And obviously what that did for women's representation and participation in sports and women's sports is an integral part of the museum and its sports curation. AJ, you're part of the legacy of both. And I wanna know, Jackie Robinson always spoke about that balance and how difficult it was being, you know, you want to be a really good baseball player. He was a black man in society in the 40s and 50s, but he was also a trailblazer. For somebody like you, and I also want to point out, we're looking at the first ever softball gold glove winner right here. So, look, you know, that's legit. What is that sense of responsibility, what is that sense of responsibility like for you? Obviously, one, covering a sport, playing in a sport, but also knowing that you're representative and you're a motivation for generations of young kids that you'll probably never even meet. What does that level of responsibility feel like?
To me, it feels like an honor. You know, I think sometimes people can feel overwhelmed when you step into a role of being a role model sometimes. But for me, it is truly incredible to be able to inspire young women, especially young Black women, that way. Playing softball, I was one of maybe two Black women on my team always. There's never more than two Black girls on my team. And I remember my favorite player growing up was Natasha Watley. And the only reason I can tell you she was my favorite player is because she was the only Black softball player I watched. And so she went to UCLA. I bought all UCLA gear. I'm from Florida. I had no idea what I wanted to do, but because Natasha Watley was who I saw and who I resonated with, that was who I wanted to be. And so for me, throughout my journey playing softball, my entire goal was to be someone's Natasha Watley. And so when I won the Gold Glove, all I needed was a platform, you know what I'm saying? And so for me, it was an amazing opportunity to inspire women, because before I won in 2016, it was impossible, right, to win a Gold Glove. And I hope that I am now an example of impossible is just a dare, not a declaration. And so everybody's waiting to break that impossible. And thank you. But especially for Black women, because you know, you think to, when you talk about how Jackie wanted to be, or you want to inspire Black women and men on and off the field, for me it's the same thing, I think, to 2020 and what I wanted to do regarding sports, where you see so many athletes coming together to either take a knee or stand up for what it is that they believe in. And it became very difficult being one of maybe two Black women on a team, and not knowing how my white teammates would feel about the fact that I have such a strong stance. I'm very, very blunt with what I have to say. And you know, it was difficult at times realizing that my teammates were only my teammates on the field and not off. But for me, it was something that I felt, it only made me have more drive, because I knew that I wasn't the only person. I got so many messages from parents and young girls of color, Black women. They're all speaking to how the things that I'm saying, the things that I'm doing, are allowing them to feel less alone and allowing them to continue to move forward. And so, again, I just hope I'm an example of limitless possibilities, and I take that very seriously, especially in Jackie's book. He talks to what is the point of life except to impact others. And so I that is what drives me every day, to hopefully, it doesn't have to be 100 people, but I can impact one person. Look at the power of one. Jackie Robinson changed, his legacy has made so much possible for women and men in and out of sports. And so if I can impact one person to do that as well, then that's my goal.
Absolutely. Damon, did you want to jump in?
Sure. Yeah, you think about the impact of Title IX, of the Higher Education Act of 1972. It's actually not a sports law. It is about all forms of higher education, saying you can't discriminate. One of the reasons I think why we remember it as a sports law now is because sports is still lagging so far behind so many of the other spaces in higher education in terms of creating opportunities for others. But it is an incredibly important, sports is incredibly important to create these opportunities. Because what we know is that girls and women who have the opportunity to compete, they have higher GPAs, they're less likely to use drugs, less likely to become pregnant. And so we all benefit as a society by creating these opportunities, and why it's important that we continue to increase those opportunities so that everyone has an opportunity to learn the lessons and the values that we associate with sports.
So, you know, we're talking a lot about Jackie Robinson. Obviously, him breaking the color barrier to play in Major League Baseball is huge. But, you know, we're still having conversations about Black leadership in these executive roles. And hence why we have my new friend, Elaine, here on this panel. She's great. She's been with the Boston Red Sox for 34 years.
Yes.
That is beautiful. That is amazing. And, yeah, clap that up. I mean, this is important, because 75 years ago, she couldn't have been on this panel. I couldn't have been on this panel. We would have just been talking to each other outside drinking a Coca-Cola. Like, one of these days, it's going to get better. But, you know, Elaine, I want to talk to you as somebody who's working in these upper levels of management with one of the most iconic franchises in all of sports, not just baseball, all of sports. What is April 15 feel like for you every year? Well, like what emotions go through you when you think about Jackie Robinson and you watch the game that he changed on that field day in and day out?
Well, I mean, April 15th is very special within Major League Baseball, but I also am a recipient of a Jackie Robinson Foundation scholarship. Oh, so wow. While I was going to school and studying at St. John's University, sports management, I had been selected as one of the scholars to receive, scholarship aid. I have feel a really close connection to the Robinson family because of my gratitude for receiving that scholarship. Also, Rachel Robinson has been a mentor throughout my career, especially during the early part of my career. So April 15th, it's not just April 15th for me. I have such reverence for Jackie Robinson and for his family and for Sharon, who worked in Major League Baseball, so I know Sharon as well.
Absolutely. And you just mentioned Rachel Robinson. You can't talk about Jackie without talking about Rachel. And if you've read his autobiography, she's not just important. She's a lifeline. She's critical to his story. When you hear Jackie Robinson, you just think like, oh, it's the guy that broke the color barrier in baseball. He stole home and for the Dodgers. Like, yeah, that's part of the story, but we could have an entirely different discussion on Rachel Robinson, how important she is, because there's so many fascinating elements of Jackie Robinson's life and the people who were in it. And Greg, I want to talk to you, and feel free to take it wherever you want to go with it. Depending on who you talk to, Jackie Robinson off the field was even more captivating than he was on the field, and that's saying something. So what were the complexities of Jackie's political decisions and his civil rights activism, and how do they resonate now, over a half a century later?
I appreciate that question, and I think like everybody else, I'm glad to be here.
Absolutely.
And between this museum, the Museum of African Art, and the Anacostia Museum, these are the black spaces in the Federal Museum, so it's always a pleasure to be here. And April is always a time, and I think probably everybody has read this. I usually try to revisit it every April. So we evoke the ancestor. This actually is one of the editions that Rachel Robinson published. And you have had so many Robinson scholars in class over the years. And it's a real honor, particularly at the HBCUs, when we get those Robinson scholars. Especially when they meet, go to New York, and say, go and say hello to everybody, come back, tell us how it was. So we start with the ancestor right quick. As I write this 20 years later, I cannot stand and sing the anthem. I cannot salute the flag. I know that I am a black man in a white world in 1972, in 1947, at my birth in 1919. I know that I never had it made. Maybe there's one or two people who have never read his memoir, Never Had It Made, which came out the week after he made Transition. Jack Robinson probably the least important thing in some ways about him was the athletics. That was the point of entry. And this past week, I always play for my students the 1949 song, William Count Basie. Did you see Jackie Robinson hit that ball? And then I pull up newspaper articles, because the black press, in fact, the headline in the Chicago Defender, and I think maybe the Amsterdam News too, was Robinson, first Negro since Fleet Moses. He was not the first. We know Moses Fleetwood Walker in the 19th century for the Blue Stockings in Toledo. In fact, Cap Anson wouldn't even get on the field with him. This racist. And anyway, but politics is inseparable. I mean, AJ, your work on the field is a point of entry. Mm-hmm. You become, and we were talking before, I can't even imagine being in the front office grappling with not only Major League Baseball, but a franchise like the Red Sox, who were the last to hire black folk. and to be there day to day. But Robinson, finally, born in 1919, you know, ends up, what, 1920, I think is when they locked Jack Johnson up. It wasn't Leavenworth, right? About 2 hours from where Jackie Robinson ended up in, brought into the military, and asking Joe Lewis, can they have some black officers? I mean, political from jump, right? And a Buffalo soldier, Robinson. And in 1920, the year after he's born in Georgia, and then of course his mom moves them to Pasadena, well, that's when Andrew Rube Foster started the Negro Leagues. And as Jackie Robinson writes, or I say Jackie, but I love saying Jack Roosevelt, because you know how white sports writers in particular put that E on the end. That's why Roberto Clemente, my name is Roberto, you're not calling me Bobby. So at any rate, the whole concept of black business, when Robinson writes Branch Rickey, I loved him, he's like a second father, but make no mistake about it, he was a keen businessman. So you hit the Negro Leagues in their chest. In fact, the Monarchs threatened to sue the Dodgers. You raiding our, you know? And then one of the white owners of the Monarchs calls Branch Rickey like, no, we good. We don't want to be perceived, really? Is this what we doing here? But when, in chapter after chapter, Robinson is in dialogue with everybody. And he doesn't shut people down. Malcolm X roasts him. He talks to Malcolm, they go back and forth, they agree to disagree on certain things, but he said, one thing Malcolm said when he was working for Chock Full of Nuts, he said, you know, I agree with Malcolm. I don't just want the coffee, I want to own the store and the land underneath it. He and Martin Luther King disagree on the Vietnam War. He writes his column, King calls him, they talk for hours. He says, I don't know if I'm right where you are, bro, but I really kind of do understand. Then they try to sic him on Paul Robeson, and they have a black man working for the House Un-American Activity Committee who makes the call to the Dodgers. He and Sister Rachel, who I think turns 100 this summer, right? My God. They're talking to each other. Should I go? Should I go? He's getting mail saying, don't go, you be a sellout, or go. He goes down there. He doesn't even attack Paul Robeson, but the white press pretends like he does. And Robeson doesn't return it. And so he writes in here, if they call me today, I wouldn't go. Just like Jesse Owens in his last memoir, I Have Changed, said they sent me in 68, Mexico City, to those young people to calm down. And they damn near cussed me out. I left in tears. That was a mistake. Robinson is constantly moving toward trying to understand. He's unapologetically black. He wants the society to change. And we can talk more about all the other stuff, Rockefeller and politics, Nixon and that a little bit later. But, you know, sports and entertainment, it's a hell of a thing when you're in part of a race where they want to stick a microphone in front of a ball player or entertainer for the political opinion. But in Robinson's case, he took that and turned it on his head. And I think we're only beginning to think about Jack Robinson in the way we should think about him.
You know, I want to pose, I'm going to ask you, Damion, but I want everybody to chime in on this if you have something to say. It was called the Noble Experiment. Branch Rickey, he did not just wake up one day and be like, you know what, I'm going to sign a black player. This was something that Branch Rickey wanted to do for, in his eyes, he thought it was morally right. But as you said, as Jack Robinson said, there was a business interest in doing that as well. Damion, can you explain to us what exactly was the Noble Experiment, and how did Jack Robinson eventually become the one? Because he wasn't the only one. He looked at a lot of people, but.
Yeah, I think part of what Rickey tried to do is to scientize his kind of search for the one person who's going to integrate Major League Baseball. So one of the things he did is he latched on to something that became known as the Tannenbaum thesis. And Tannenbaum was a professor at NYU, and what he said is that if you put people of different colors together for a common goal, they overcome their prejudice. And so he used the Tannenbaum thesis as the intellectual justification. That thesis has proved to be wrong, but it provided him with the scholarly kind of undergirding. When you go to the Negro Leagues and think about the players in 45 and 46, Jackie Robinson's probably not the best Negro League player. You know, he played one season in the Negro League, and if you go back to his UCLA career where he played football, ran track, played basketball and baseball, baseball was probably his worst sport. He was a 112 hitter as a college baseball player. So, but there are other things about Jackie Robinson that make him a viable person. One, he was a military hero. He served in World War II. Second thing is that he was college educated. He had spent a couple of years at UCLA, so he was used to being around white people. The third thing is that he wasn't a Southerner, so he wasn't used to dealing with the customs of the South, and Branchwick, he knew that he would stand up and fight back, because he got court-martialed while he was in the military, because he refused to abide by some of the Southern customs when he was stationed in Texas. So he's someone who had a fighting kind of spirit. The other thing that's going on is you also have the second great migration. So you have this critical mass of African Americans moving up who are going to support Jackie Robinson when he gets on the playing field. And everywhere the Dodgers went during Jackie Robinson's first season, except for Cincinnati, they set attendance records. And it was, people came to cheer, but people also came to boo. But even if you came to boo, you had to buy a ticket.
Right.
And so attendance records get set everywhere. And so there are all of these larger political things that are kind of coalescing and coming together to create this moment. And then you also have the post-World War II period, where African Americans are saying, look, we want more rights, we want more freedoms. You have independence movements globally starting to take place. India becomes independent. So there is this air of expectation for people of color globally that also plays into now this is the moment where Jackie Robinson is gonna be this one person who is supposed to show us that integration works, that African Americans can be accepted in places of high value in society. And for African Americans, Jackie Robinson's success becomes a metaphor for opportunity. And what African Americans are using Jackie Robinson to say is that if you open the doors to business, if you open the doors to medicine, if you open the doors to the legal field, this is what we can accomplish. And so you can go anywhere in Black America in 1947 and not hear the question, how did Jackie do today?
One of the more powerful stories that I think Malcolm X talked about it a lot. He would calculate Jackie's batting average every day. He would listen to the games on the radio, and that made him so proud as a Black man who's at that point in time incarcerated. And it's just amazing how much the Black community was invested in this. And in his book, Jackie talks about the fact that like Black people would come to these games, and obviously you can imagine the type of things that people were saying to them in the stands. You can imagine what Jackie was going through, and he was so nervous at first, because it was like at a certain point in time, like these men and these women are only going to be able to take but so much verbal abuse. But it was kind of like an unspoken truth or reality between all of them. It was like, look, we can't react the way that they want us to react, because then that would be counterproductive of like what we want to do. And I think that was emblematic of Jackie Robinson in his entire life. And you know, AJ, I want to toss this back to you. One of the things that Jackie said right before he passed, and I could be wrong, I think it was like right before the 1972 World Series, he was I want to see a Black manager in baseball. Now, half century later, here you are, you're a Black one, you're playing in the sport, you're covering the sport. And obviously the talks of, you know, diversity and baseball have been going on for, you know, quite some time now. But for you and your vantage point within the sport, what opportunities do you see, you know, evolving within the game of baseball that can, you know, provide tangible results for that conversation and providing diversity for the sport? What opportunities excite you the most? Because I know you work with all levels of players as well, so.
Yeah, I would say that, I mean, I just feel like Black people are the blueprint. And when it comes down to trying to make something fun or exciting, you know, you look to what it is that Black athletes can bring to the game. And I think that Major League Baseball is starting to see that more, and you start to see welcoming things like the Players Alliance, which CeCe Sabathia and some other players have started. And then you see just Black athletes. I mean, it was a few years ago, but you know, the first player that ever took a knee, he was blackballed from the MLB. And now you see all the teams, right, having a day where it is acceptable to do that. Or, you know, you see these things where they're trying to, you know, continue to build on Black culture and bring that into the sport more, realizing that that's what made, I mean, when you think about the athletes that came from the Negro League into Major League Baseball, that is why it was exciting. Those players made it exciting, made people want to come to those games. And for whatever reason, it seems like we've gotten away from that, or seems gotten away from realizing that. And I think now we're moving back toward understanding the value that Black athletes have in this game and wanting to continue to build up and bring them more into the game. Baseball as well as softball, understanding that they have a space in baseball, they have a space in softball. They are just as talented, just as valuable. It is not a white sport. It is a sport that you are just as good at and can be. And you know, I think it's important to make sure that young athletes know that they don't have to just play basketball or football. They can go out and be Jackie Robinson, Hank Aaron, CeCe Sabathia, King Griffey Jr. Like, these opportunities are available to them, and I hope that more young players, baseball and softball, again, for me, I hope I'm an example in softball as to seeing yourself in that space and knowing what it is that you're able to do, and I hope that that's what we see in baseball as well.
I hope so. Growing up, those players were inspiration for me, too. One of my favorite sporting moments of all time is Ken Griffey Jr. in the 1993 Home Run Derby. That's when he had his hat backwards. He had the gold ear ring, and he hit the warehouse at Camden Yards. And he didn't even win the Home Run Derby. I can't even remember who won it that year, but I remember that moment. I was like, that's cool as hell. Like, I'm aware of my hat backwards for picture day when I go to school. That did not happen. But no, there is such a value of tapping into cultural currency, because you can't put a dollar sign on cultural currency. And I do hope what you just said is the case moving forward. And you know, Elaine, I wanna come back to you. Just being in your position of power and your leadership role for the time that you have, what has brought you the most joy in terms of progress that you've seen? And what does progress moving forward actually look like in terms of Black leadership in baseball?
Well, there's definitely been a lot of progress. When I first started, that was around the time when, I don't know if you are all familiar with the Al Campanis remarks that he made on, I think it was Ted Koppel's show, and discussing Jackie Robinson, and I think he was asked, why are there so few minorities in, as general managers and field managers, and his response was appalling. You know, Blacks don't have the necessities. So when I started in baseball, it was in that environment. And at that time, there was a lot of pressure. There was a lot of public pressure for clubs to hire more Black employees. So I did notice at that time that a lot of the clubs were, you know, their numbers were going up, not necessarily people being hired at, managerial levels. But now, through the years, we've seen, people break into the ownership rank, in terms of investing, being an investor in a club. Derek Jeter, he was the president of the Miami Marlins, just recently left, but he was an owner. At the Red Sox, our team is actually owned by Fenway Sports Group. That's the ownership level. And LeBron James and Maverick Carter have recently invested at the ownership, at that ownership level. So that is above the Red Sox, Liverpool Football Club. They just acquired the Pittsburgh Penguins, and we have a investment in the NASCAR. So I would say that it is hopeful, you know, that we see people breaking in at that level. I think investment in professional sports seems to be something that is drawing a lot of attention from you know, black athletes. Have some trailblazers, you know, with Michael Jordan, and so I would say that I have seen through the course of my career, you know, I was promoted to assistant general manager at the same time as, you know, Bob Watson and Frank Robinson, and then they went on to the general manager ranks. So it is happening, obviously not as quickly or as fully as it needs to, but I am an eternal optimist, and
you have to be.
Think we are moving in the right direction.
Did y'all tell LeBron he can't wear Yankees hats anymore? He used to do it all the time. And I'm pretty sure that was a back
hit. I will let Mr. John Henry tell him that.
I understand. Greg, I want to come back to you, because you mentioned in your previous answer, obviously, Jackie's relationship with Richard Nixon and the political nature of that. Mm-hmm. I'm going to take it wherever you want to take it. What's the most misunderstood part about Jackie Robinson's legacy in your eyes?
Jackie Robinson said, I'm black first. My life, my work, I'm black. He said, I'm not a radical integrationist, but I'm not a separatist. So when he's arguing with Malcolm, he said, I don't believe we should have a separate thing, but he says, when Malcolm comes back to Mecca, and he then quotes Malcolm at length in the book, of course, his memoir, he says, Malcolm understood it shouldn't just be here, we should have a connection with our black brothers everywhere. It's an internationalism in Jackie's thought. And I think, you know, we in Africana studies, we're trying to develop a methodology that allows us, it's okay to be black. It's okay, you ain't got to explain your humanity to other people. So we had to create a methodology where the first question you ask to get it out of the way is, who are black people to other people? I think that is the Jackie Robinson narrative. Who are black people to other people? We constantly trying to explain. But then the question we want to get to each other, that's a different question. Jack Robinson, I think it's misunderstood, oh, I want somebody with the courage not to fight back. And then season two, okay, we good. Robinson, as you say, he's a football player. You know why he's stealing home? Which one of them white catchers wants to stand in front of an All-American level football player who's just looking to take your whole spine? I'm good. Robinson. Jackie Robinson comes out of his office one time, 125th Street, right? He's coming across the streets where he was at the bank, right? And I guess some police officers helped me that had been shot or something in Harlem. So he's in front of the Apollo, and a cop starts harassing him. Robinson's ready to erase this man off the planet. He has to calm himself down. He's at the 1964 Republican convention. Barry Goldwater is now going to take the White Nationalist Party where it is today. Robinson sees it. He's got words for Kennedy. He don't believe Kennedy's sincere. He laces Kennedy up in 60. Nixon, he's begrudging with, but by 64, it's clear where it's going. And he writes, I tried to say the Republican, but they taken it somewhere else. He's at the convention, and this white delegate gets a little bass in his voice, wants to get a little husky. Robinson has to stop himself, because he says, I believe in retaliatory. I mean, no, he didn't call it retaliatory violence. What was the, my point is this. Jackie Robinson is not a, like black people in this country, I'm angry, okay? No. Robinson is playing it straight down the middle as best he can in his life. Everybody he's engaging with, he's trying to be an honest, open dialogue, and he's not gonna budge from who he is. And I think that is the lesson that we have not yet learned. Even in this museum, which is a shrine, you can't be everything to everybody. Tell your story, and like August Wilson said, I'm not writing to a black audience or a white audience. I'm writing out of my experience, and y'all find your humanity in it. That is Jackie Robinson. And I think if we don't, when we miss that, we miss everything about it, and it just grates on me when I see anybody, I don't care whether it's Ken Burns, I don't care whether it's Jackie Robinson helped us grow as a nation. There is no nation called the United States of America. Read what Robinson wrote. There is a country, but there's no common identity. Because if there were a common identity, you wouldn't be shooting black people in the street. I think that's very important. And you know, don't take my word for it, read what Jack Robinson wrote.
Absolutely. Look, we've got about 5 minutes left in this. I want to pose this last question to everybody, and I'm not even going to say who should answer first. The first one to talk is going to be the first one to answer. It sounds like an easy question, or it sounds like an expected question, but how has Jackie Robinson's life changed you as a person, professionally and personally? Don't all answer at once.
I'll go first. In 1997, on the 50th anniversary of Jackie Robinson integrating Major League Baseball, Rachel Robinson came back to UCLA, and I was a graduate student at UCLA at the time. And she was working with this esteemed professor on a rampersad to write a biography of Jackie Robinson. And at the time, I'm like, man, don't another Jackie Robinson biography. We know so much about Jackie Robinson. But she thought it was important to have this book written because Robinson's legacy had been sanitized. And it's important to remember that by the time Jackie Robinson left Major League Baseball, he was one of the most hated men in the game. And it has to do with the fact that people wanted to point at Jackie Robinson and say, hey, look at what we've done. Look at how far we've come. And Jackie Robinson was always saying, you can do more. Jackie Robinson played 10 seasons, and when he retired, there were still three or four teams that had not integrated. On the 25th anniversary, he writes, I never had it made. That's the 25th anniversary, and Major League Baseball is trying to celebrate this moment. They invite him to the World Series to honor him, and he says, why aren't there any black managers? And so people began to see him as too grand, too opinionated, as ungodly. Because he was always saying there's more that the game can do and there's more that society can do to give African Americans their full rights and equality. And so when Rachel came on the 50th anniversary to make that argument, it was one of the main reasons why I'm here today. Because it's at that point that I started to think about, okay, how can I study sports as a way to share the larger history of African Americans. So it's his legacy has had a profound impact upon me.
Absolutely. Well, we got a couple of questions from the audience. I know I said that's for everybody to answer, but I want to make sure we get at least some of these questions in. I'm going to throw this to Elaine and AJ. This is a question from the audience. How do we increase the acknowledgement of women in sports as athletes and executives?
That's an interesting question. I think that I was surprised in a good way. The Red Sox have put in an installation in Fenway Park to celebrate women in baseball, and I actually have not even had a chance yet to go out and walk and see it. But I was so very, I've worked there for such a long time, and to be acknowledged that way, and to be able to have other girls go out at Fenway Park and see that, girls and boys, because I think it's important for all of us to understand that women, you know, working in baseball make very significant contributions. So I think that a way to acknowledge, I've seen in baseball a push to use social media to highlight women that have done things in the game.
Absolutely.
I think the stories need to be told. I bet if I were to ask a show of fans, who in here knew that I was the first woman to win a Rollins Gold Glove? And see, that's my point, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you don't know what you don't know. And in order for women, especially women in sports, to continue to get acknowledgement and the respect that is so rightfully due, those stories need to be told. And they need to be told in the manner that they're told about men, right? Men are spoken about as almost heroes, right? You even have nicknames for all of these superstars, men, and it makes them seem like something more than human, right? They're bigger than, and it acknowledges them as superstar athletes. Women, sometimes the jargon surrounding women when we're spoken about, it's, oh, it was a great job, or it's a lot more dainty, right? It's a lot more calm in the demeanor. Yeah, diminished. And I think you should describe me as AJ Andrews, the best to ever do it. Sliding, diving around that play was something I've never seen, man or woman. Not the best woman to make the play. No, that was the best play that I've seen in a really long time. And until women are described in that manner, and not this is the best woman, whatever, but the best XYZ, and talked about in just the praise that the men get in that same manner, then that's when I think the acknowledgement will begin to grow. You have to acknowledge us the way you acknowledge men, and not just the 4% that you, the ESPN, or you know, media coverage is only 4% for women. That mm-hmm. has to change. Yeah, and hopefully more people know my story now, but I think in order for not just myself, but all women in sports, those stories need to be told.
Absolutely, there you go. I think we have time for maybe one more, Greg, you've been mentioning I've Never Had It Made, and we've been speaking about Rachel Robinson, you know, a lot over the course of this program. But in terms of how Jackie spoke about her in the book, mm-hmm. can you speak a little bit about Rachel Robinson's impact on Jack and how profound that was?
I think it actually is of a piece of what we just heard. Mm-hmm. You know, Western models of human social relations that are gendered are very patriarchal. I don't even know if they can be reverse engineered. When you look at the way other groups in the world, other cultures in the world approach that question of gender, it can differ depending on where you are. And so the way that he writes about her and the way she has written and spoken and lived about him since he's become an ancestor is we. So it's not a, you know, you saw the Giants. I guess they had the first woman to be on the field as a coach, first base coach, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know how she got there, right?
Yeah.
Because the brother got thrown out the game, the black dude who was the first base coach. So I'm saying, that's cool. But I'm just saying, okay, I'm cheering for this white woman. And I'm thinking about Althea Gibson. And I'm thinking about all the black women I don't know who are in, you know, front office whose names I don't know. And the fact that we just met tonight, I'm thinking, duh, like you said, AJ, what? So I'm saying, I have to say this. You know, the lived reality of race is the centering, anchoring identity for black folk in the modern world. When Jack Robinson's writing about Rachel Robinson, she's writing and talking about him, they are a team. And not just a team, it's her mother and his mother and their family and their children. Then Jack Jr., you know, dies. But then you got David, who's halfway around the world in Tanzania between them. And then you got Sharon writing children's books about when he would get Kurt Flood and them and go south. And then it was so much we that she had to remind him, hold on, I got a life too. So I think is the thing that allows us a point of entry to reimagine how we even talk or have these conversations. Because gender don't mean nothing when black folks show up, because Shira Clark says somehow blood always answers when blood calls blood. And then you looking like, but I thought we, it ain't no we. It's the only we got.
Absolutely. AJ, this question is for you as well. Can you talk about the experience of being the first softball player of winning the gold gloves? And what was that emotion like in that moment when somebody told you, like, hey, you got a gold glove right now? And what did that feel like for you?
Yeah. Well, prior to when I knew they were going to be giving a gold glove to a woman for the first time, I honestly didn't think anything of it. I thought it was going to be some just side version, like, oh, yeah, we're going to just slide it over to the girls. But then when they told me that it was the gold glove that Major League Baseball players win for being the best defensive players on the field, then I got really excited. And I learned that I was the finalist, so out of three people. But when we got to the ceremony, when they were announcing who was the winner, I was sitting there thinking of the other finalist names, so you know, so you don't get disappointed if you don't hear your name. And so, but so it's the point where they called my name and I didn't even hear it. And one of my teammates had to actually tap me and say, AJ, it's you. And I felt an overwhelming amount of emotion. And I was walking up, and it's very interesting to describe because I don't even think I felt it for myself. Like, I wasn't even necessarily happy that, ooh, yes, I'm the one that won. It was more so, wow, like, I just made history, and I just made this impossible thing possible for someone else. This glass ceiling that seemed unattainable is now something that someone's gonna look to, a young girl's gonna say, ooh, it's my goal to be a Gold Glover now. And that was never going to have happened prior to me walking up to that stage and winning that award. And so I think those were all those emotions that came to me. And to me, it just made my desire to motivate and inspire just that much greater. And I'd go and speak to so many young girls all the time. And my message, the ending message I always give them is that there is nothing that they cannot do. I remember I had a project for my master's class, and I went and asked around a softball field what these young girls wanted to be when they grew up. And this was before I won the Gold Glove. And so many of them said doctor, teacher. No one, I think only one girl said a professional softball player. And then after I won the Gold Glove and some people had recognized me, I went and asked the same question. And the difference was exponential. So many young girls, I want to be a professional softball player. I want to win a Gold Glove like you. This is what I want to do. And I can't tell you the amount of pride that I felt in that moment. And so winning the Gold Glove, yes, I'm excited for myself, but I'm more excited for the history of women in sport, and especially the young girls that I am there, Natasha Watley. So. Mm-hmm.
You won a Gold Glove. And my crowning athletic achievement is trying to recreate Michael Jordan's flu game. That did not work too well for me as an 11-year-old. I saw Michael Jordan had the flu. He dropped 40 points. I was like, you know what? I'm going to get the flu, and I'm going to drop 40 points in my game.
You intentionally wanted to get the flu.
I intentionally got myself sick. My mom's watching this at home, and she can attest to this. She was supposed to be here tonight. So needless to say, I was benched the entire second half. Right. I went 0-for-8. I didn't even hit the rim. That's when I knew. I was like, Justin, you need to write about sports. You need to talk to athletes. Like, the most impressive athletic thing I've done recently is 10 straight days on a Peloton. So congrats to you. You are.
I don't know if I can do that. That's impressive, actually.
Is that a real clever or is that sarcastic? Anyways, no, but we have to wrap up now. But again, I just want to thank my esteemed panelists. Y'all were incredible. I hope y'all got as much out of this conversation that I did. Please clap it up for them again.
Thank you, bro.
Oh, thank you. It's something I do want to say, like, sometimes your purpose will lead you to where you're supposed to be, and it'll save you in ways that you don't even know. You keep mentioning I never had it made. One of the most fascinating facts in that book to me is in 1941, Jack was, he was in the military, he was stationed in Hawaii, he was playing professional football. His assignment ended and he went back to California on December 5th, 1941. Y'all know what happened 2 days later?
It's crazy.
Pearl Harbor.
It's crazy.
Jackie Robinson could have been at Pearl Harbor that day. Jackie Robinson could have died December 7th, 1941. And if that happens, we might not be on this stage right
now.
That's right. So whatever your purpose is, whatever your passion is, allow it to lead you, because it will change your life. And you might be able to change the world because of it too. So if that's, for me, that's what Jackie Robinson is. That's what he represents. And I want to thank each and every person that came out here in this Oprah Winfrey theater that we're in right now, and everybody watching on YouTube, thank you all so much. Have a great weekend, and I can't wait to talk to everybody out in the lobby, I guess. Taking my water with me.
You don't.
Oh, my mic is still
on. Okay, so obviously. But I'm
Before you leave, a couple things before you leave. Please sit down. So I have to ask you to sit down because there are a couple people I would like to ask to stand. If you are an object donor to the sports gallery, please stand. You've donated objects in the sports gallery. This is George and Candace Joseph. One of the great honors of my job is I get to go into the living rooms of people and they entrust this museum to share their stories. And these are a couple of my favorite people who have made sure that we have Joe Louis artifacts to tell his incredible story. And so I didn't want to do a program without acknowledging our object donors. And so I'd like to invite my colleague Derek Sims, who'll do one more acknowledgement.
Thank you, Damion. Good evening, everyone. Before I wrap up for the evening, can we just give one more round of applause to that amazing panel and moderator? Thank you so much. My name is Derek Sims, as Damion said, and my role on the team is to build relationships with individuals and organizations who want to invest in this museum's growth. Since this museum first opened its doors back in 2016, the sports world has been some of our largest and earliest supporters, both professional athletes and sports leagues. So as we look towards the future under the visionary leadership of Director Young, we launched a new campaign, and it's the Living History Campaign. And just as Justin talked about when he was moderating, history is happening every day among us. We're all history makers, and for this museum to continue to have an impact for generations to come, we launched this campaign to build an endowment to make sure we have the financial resources to continue to innovate for generations. And so what I want to do today is thank the inaugural members of the Sports Leadership Council. That was a program we started to allow leaders in the sports world that wanted to invest in the museum's growth. And so before we end tonight, I want to thank once again the Brooklyn Nets and New York Liberty Foundation, the Robert Kraft family, and the New England Patriots Charitable Foundation, Spurs Sports and Entertainment and Spurs Give, and the Washington Commanders. Their generous support helps bolster our museum's core initiatives, including the Sports Race Initiative, which, like programs tonight, showcase how sports matter well beyond the playing field and how influential athletes can be catalysts for systemic change. So as tonight's discussion showed us, our nation still has a long way to go. We still grapple with ongoing racial reckoning and other widespread disparities, but there's no place better than the Smithsonian to provide the historical context that helps us understand how we can have the critical conversations about race, about social justice, equality, and access to the American dream. We thank all of you for joining us tonight to celebrate Jackie Robinson's enduring legacy, and we hope you'll continue to support this museum as we do our great work to tell the full story of American history through the African-American lens and create a better future for us all. Thanks again, and good night.
Talking about Juneteenth, it was the 20th, but the 19th.